As radical in their political views as they were in their art, these artists created irregular shaped canvases structured with flat planes of colour and pure geometric forms, insisting on invention rather than abstraction from nature. Working under a collective ethos that echoed their Marxist ideals, they sought to produce a geometric art that could contribute to social transformation. Fusing revolutionary politics with a radically new take on European constructivist traditions, the Argentine avant-garde artists were invariably marginalized in their native country. On the contrary, the Brazilian concrete artists, who emerged in the early 1950s, enjoyed the support of a government eager to cast the country and its cultural production in a modern light.
Architecture, painting, poetry, at this time in Brazil, it's all sort of together, it's all part of the same thing.
Artists in Sao Paulo had great hope in reason, rationality, and scientific progress, and aimed to create an art that could intellectually elevate the masses. Many Sao Paulo artists also worked as architects, engineers, industrial and graphic designers, creating works that were clear, precise, and indebted to Gestalt theory.
Within these nice sweeping spirals, we have this jagged structure, and really mathematics is about placing structure within a system. One of these jagged pieces is a rotation of the other. So we get into the mathematics of rotation, which could involve matrices and iterated function systems, and the idea of naming points on a structure and then moving it with some type of reflection, rotation, or with a matrix through a function. There's all kinds of interesting meshing of mathematics going on here. Here's that logarithmic spiral that comes out of Fibonacci, comes out of golden mean. Could it be that we just have to think that way? Maybe. Whether you're a mathematician or an artist, you think that way because if we're built that way, maybe that's how our thoughts come out. Maybe that's how the chemical reactions go on, such that we have to think the way we're built, which is a fractal situation. Is any of this really creative, or is it just inherent and we discover it? It has to come out whether we liked it or not. And maybe the greatest artists are the ones that can do the discovery and not necessarily create.
Artists in Rio de Janeiro were interested in less rigid geometries and in the organic and interactive possibilities of abstract forms. Rio artists challenged the Sao Paulo concretists' strict adherence to rationalist geometry. In this period, the colourful forms of Elio Oiticica's concrete works begin to move. His underlying grid structures wobble off kilter, while his vibrant monochromatic paintings become spatial reliefs that unfurl into the space of the viewer.
In this painting by Elio Oiticica, it's almost as if there's something behind this grid that's starting to move it, starting to shift it, as if it's breathing somehow. It's a much looser kind of geometry that we're seeing.
Oiticica was eager to integrate art into everyday life and to transform spectators into active participants in the creative process. Oiticica brought geometric art into marginalized Brazilian communities with his cape-like parangoles, meant to be worn by samba dancing participants.
He started painting, then he moved the paintings off the wall, and from there, I think that's when he moved into the poor neighborhoods and started to add other things into his work, like sand or soil. It really changes. It's very, very, very beautiful to see the way his work changed. But at the end, I think he was more interested in the people than the object.
Beginning in the mid-1950s, Venezuelan kinetic artists also proposed innovative strategies for engaging viewers in participatory experiences, creating abstract works that incorporate actual and implied movement. These artists investigated serial repetition as a means of dynamizing the pictorial field, the properties of color, and the dynamics of perception. Carlos Cruz Diaz was most concerned with the psychological and the phenomenological impact of colour on viewers. He turned his investigations of colour theory and perception into a radical chromatic kineticism, with works that produce an ever-changing array of internal geometries and colours as spectators moved in front of them. While Cruz Diaz spurred spectators to walk past his faceted mural constructions to activate their shifting colours, Otero focused on virtual movement created in viewers' minds rather than on the surface of his paintings. As the eye scans their slick surfaces, the coloured bands appear to flicker, advancing before and receding behind grids that seem barely able to contain them.
Otero described his subject as, quote, nothing, except for the act of painting itself. Otero reinforced the materiality of the surface, creating a system in which color becomes line, the edges of the paint become drawing, and the internal structure conveys a painterly order.
Soto began investigating experiential properties of physical and virtual movement with a synthesis of two- and three-dimensional formats. Early experiments with optics prompted forays into relief-like kinetic works in which optical vibrations were created by wooden sticks suspended against notched or painted backgrounds. These vibration works offered participants new perceptual and corporeal experiences, transforming them into integral living components of the work. German-born artist and architect Gertrudis Goldschmidt, known as Gego, created sculptures and environmental installations out of industrially produced modules in Venezuela. Her works involved a transparency of process as well as a form absent from the three kineticists' projects. Exploring the evocative potential of three basic elements, the point, the line, and the void, in abstract drawings, prints, and sculptures. Gago worked in an amorphous space between two and three dimensions, weaving together simultaneous impressions of enclosure, openness, and infinite extension. Gago eschewed conventions of perspective, mass, and volume, presenting space as a pliable material and prefabricated units as the building blocks of an ever-expansive abstraction.
So where we really come in this exhibition is to the kind of triumph of that integration of art into life, which is something that all of the artists in the exhibition had really been trying to do. And it's a very old avant-garde sort of aspiration, which was to have an art that would live in the world outside the confines of the art institution as we understand it. This is an art that is immersive in the sense that it asks the person to really go into the piece, to really be part of it, to interact with it, to revisit it every time that they see it. And the great sort of culminating expression of that would be, for example, the large penetrable sculptures by Soto, where you literally walk into and through the piece and through the geometric form. And I think that's a moment that really crowns this desire for an art that would be hopeful, forward-looking, and transformative.
The history of abstract art may be seen in part as the history of compartmentalizing spaces, after which we then create the organization of these compartmentalized spaces, and we see this and we experience this as the formal systems that constitute our abstract world. Even today, we are enraptured by geometry, by the new geometries, the geometries of video games and the arithmetic mysteries of the computer. We are enraptured by the geometric fields embodied today in the glowing images of the electronic extensions of our own bodies.